And we're live. That's enough of that. Don't have any music today because I am broadcasting via my phone. I have trouble with other things, and at least to get on here, I decided I would use my phone. There actually are some things to talk about this week, besides questions that came up throughout the week. A little bit of events actually happened. Most notably the draft, and so that'll be one of the things that we talk about. But I guess the biggest thing in everyone's mind is the new plans for the season, because it seems like they're going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And it doesn't look like you're going to have a very long season. It looks like the 80-ish game concept is out the window. Which brings us down to probably a 48 or 50 game schedule. And I'm going to say something that's probably a little bit controversial. I'm going to say if we get 50 games in, that's actually a success for baseball. When they shut this thing down, you know, it looked like who knows what was going to happen. And the season probably wasn't going to come around, as they say. You know, at the time that Major League Baseball shut down the season, you know, the NHL and NBA had just shut down, and they had no return date whatsoever. But even more so, as you look at other entertainment sources that were going on at the time, to give you an idea of what's going on, Wimbledon, which wasn't going to play, this was back in March, which wasn't going to play until the end of June, early July, they had canceled because they knew that they couldn't get people in stands by July 1st. You know, it was a bit of a pipe dream. The Kentucky Derby, you know, one of my favorites, postponed until September 19th. They thought that was probably a time when they could get back together. Because when you're talking about crowds, the secondary crowd is 200,000 people. But you can even look at other entertainment sources, which is something that I think is important to tell you where we are today. A bigger thing in New York than the Yankees is Broadway. And Broadway, at the same time, said they're shutting down everything. And they don't know how long it would be. And they would revisit it on June 7th. I don't know why they picked June 7th, but that was the day they were going to revisit. That day actually passed last week, and they did not decide to reopen. They decided they would kick the can down the road a little bit and said that they're going to be closed until at least the day after Labor Day, which I believe is September 7th this year. So you're looking at a situation where everybody out there that does entertainment in crowded venues was saying that there was a good chance of nothing until September. Even Major League Baseball knew that there wasn't going to be anybody in the stands. When they put that out there, you know, this time around, they're hoping that people have a short-term memory. They're hoping that people, you know, are going to just be as pissed off with the players as they always are with the players, no matter what happens. You know, there's so many people that are in love with the owners. That, you know, the owners should sell their own jersey for these people, you know. Instead of a number, they could have a dollar sign on the back. And then the people that are just ready to beat up on the players no matter what goes on, they would have something to wear. You know, you shouldn't be wearing an Altuve jersey or a Trout jersey or a DeGrom jersey because you hate the players. You should wear an owner's jersey. You should have a new style Derek Jeter jersey or whoever I can't remember the name of the family that owns the Cubs. You should have those names on the back because those are the guys you love. You'd probably make a mint of that. Actually, we wouldn't, because the truth is we don't like the owners. We like the players. We just like to bash the players for some unknown reason. I think it's jealousy. You know, I've been listening. You know, there was the offer that was made, that was put out, you know, with the Major League Baseball draft. You know, they talked about how, you know, they're going to knock it down to five rounds. And then after the fifth round, all the players would be making $20,000 a year. And I've heard this on several things, including several things on our station, several things, you know, on ESPN or whatever. And nobody ever said, and myself included, until I told this story to my brother, that, are you serious? They're going to pay them $20,000 a year? I mean, that's the pay that you get to be an assistant manager at McDonald's, right? Or, you know, or working at McDonald's if you get a bunch of overtime. It's like, that's not something that you give a highly skilled group of people in any way, shape, or form. $20,000. That's what they wanted to get. And even with that, the entire Major League Baseball thing, as you say it, when they met in March and they got together, you know, the story is the players said, we want to make sure that people are healthy. And they made the grand bargain. The bargain was, you give us service time, we'll let you reduce the number of teams in this number of games in a season, you know, and you can reduce the pay by that amount. And to this day, there is no other league that has taken a bigger pay cut than the Major League Baseball players have. The basketball players are planning on going back very soon. They had taken a 25% pay cut. The pay cut that the players are at an 82-game season is already at a 50% pay cut, and they're arguing to make it lower than that. And the NBA agreement for next season, part of the agreement to get them back in the playing, is that players are going to have to take a pay cut, which is going to put them a little under 90% of the regular pay, according to what I've read. So other leagues that you think are going on are going to moving forward, and you blame baseball for the problem, but there's a huge difference in the amount of money that the other teams are willing to play to protect their investment than what the Major League Baseball players, owners are. And so the difference isn't, you know, it isn't like Major League Baseball is worse. And Major League Baseball has the one problem is that they play their games now. And now is when the virus is at its worst. And, you know, basketball doesn't really play until October. And if we manage this correctly, the virus won't be gone in October, but it'll be more handled and will be, you know, 5 months closer to a vaccine or a reasonable treatment. And so, you know, they do have a little bit, you know, the baseball's working with something that's a little bit harder, but it's just what it is. The problem with baseball is the owners. I threw out this as a question into one of our discussion groups, and it was a general poll that people can answer whatever they want. I threw out two answers to get them started. And the question was, when was the last time you watched baseball and thought about the owners and the ownership group and the commissioner or whatever? Boy, these guys know what they're doing. And I put out as the two answers, I put it out there today because they had just offered something moving. And the other answer was never. And not a single person put anything except for never. The truth is, they've been screwing things up left and right for a very long time. The difference was, I mean, is that occasionally, the difference was in the past they had more maverick ownership that would break ranks and force players to do what, force other teams to do what they didn't want to do. Most notably, you know, and I'm always want to say nice things about the Yankees, the game misses George Steinbrenner. You know, no matter what they tried to do to capsize over, George Steinbrenner would spend past it. And then all of a sudden, if a team wanted to be competitive, they had to spend past whatever limits they'd put in place, too. Don't get me wrong, you know, they did their bit of collusion. And they did their, you know, 1986 year where only four free agents were signed. But, you know, that was because they got George Steinbrenner in on the game. And so you sort of miss that guy. You sort of need somebody to say, hey, you know what, we could win this game. It would be nice if you could move to a moment where you think to yourself that these owners actually like baseball and they don't see it as just a money-making thing. I know I'm a Cubs fan, and the guys and the Ricketts family, that's who owns the Cubs. Yeah, get yourself a Ricketts jersey with a dollar symbol on the back. You know, if you're going to be this much into the owners. The reason why the Ricketts bought the Cubs wasn't because they love the Cubs. It wasn't because of some certain things around. It's like they had made literally billions of dollars in the running stock markets, you know, through one of the online services. Not by investing, but by being the guys that people invest through. And, you know, they had went to one of the New York groups, New York investment banks, and said, how do I invest $1 billion? And those guys are smart people. And they're MBAs and they're doctorates in these things, and they've been doing it for years. And they went around and they, and somebody pitched them and goes, the best thing you can do with $1 billion is buy a baseball team. You know, you're guaranteed to make $200 or $300 million a year off of it. In many cases, more than that. And you know, and there's really no downside because it's a monopoly. And if you buy a team that has a strong, you know, built-in fan base like the Cubs, you don't even have to put together that good of a team. You know, now thankfully they were smart enough that, as good as they were moving toward that moment, that they took a second and they captured a World Series in 2016, because that buys you a lot of free time. If they had taken over the team, promised a competitive team, and not turned out a competitive team at all, they would get all the backlash. But the truth is, as much as there's reasons to dislike the Ricketts family, people like the Ricketts family enough. You know, they're not considered awful because they did something that we almost thought would never be done, which is have the Cubs win the World Series. So what was I talking about? I was in here. Huh? So at the time when they made that deal, the players said, we want to secure service time. We want this one thing, which really isn't a thing. We think that the people who are playing this game, the employees of this group, should not be in a spot where they are at risk of health level. And you can do whatever the hell you want besides that. And that's, as I said before, that's the reason why they were able to float all these bizarre balloon kind of concepts where, what if we played every game in Arizona? You know, what if we realigned the divisions? What if we put a DH in to protect the pitchers? You know, all these things they can do unilaterally because they're given that. And one of the interesting things is they were allowed to change the Major League Baseball draft unilaterally without the Major League Baseball. That's one of the things that they conceded to on that. And if you think about that, as there's only 5 rounds of drafting, under the old system, you would be paying bonuses up to the 12th round of $100,000 in most cases. Yeah, some guys would come in underneath that, and some guys would take less than that. But if you think about it, that agreement that they made not only cut their salaries, but it already saved them, based on the change in the way the draft went, about $60 million. And then you get that report that TBS has just signed a billion-plus deal to continue broadcasting baseball playoffs. It's hard to imagine those guys crying poor. They say they're losing a certain amount of money, whatever it is. We're losing $126 million every game we miss. They're not actually losing that money. Like, it's not like they had a bank account with $200 million in it, and then a day passes, now they have $80 million in it. What they're losing is they're losing the money that they would have made had there been baseball. That is a loss, but it's not the same as losing the money. It's like they lose potential earnings. And it's kind of things that people deal with all the time without any kind of people backing up on it. You know, you get sick, you miss a week of work, you miss something, and most Americans miss a week. A lot of Americans don't have sick days. They miss a week of pay. A lot of people had to take time off with this coronavirus thing, you know, against their will, and they lost pay. And no one's coming around saying, well, we just spread that off on somebody else. A couple interesting things about what those guys did say in their thing. Look at this here. The Major League Baseball Players Association, their counter offers had an opt-out provision, which is something that I've been saying all along has to be there, because medically you're not going to get a green light to play everywhere. You know, if they don't think it's medically feasible to, you know, have the Lion King play on Broadway, it's probably not medically feasible for the Mets to play in Citi Field. You know, and there's something that, and there are probably certain places where it's perfectly reasonable for them to play. You know, I haven't heard really bad things about how Kansas City's handling this thing, because they're a little bit more remote. And there are places like that. where they, so there's some places where they could play, some places where they can't. You would think.